When we say to ourselves, you must go on, the reason is, you see, that we are not living in the eternal now, where reality is. We are always thinking that the satisfaction of life will be coming later. Don't kid yourself. Only suckers put hope in the future. There isn't much of a future. You're going to die. So, therefore, this hope for the future is a hoax. It's a perfect hoax. Because you're not fully alive now, you think maybe someday you will be. Look, supposing I ask you, what did you do yesterday? Most people will say, well, I got up at 7:30 and I brushed my teeth. And I read the newspaper over a cup of coffee. And then I looked at the clock and dressed and got in the car and drove downtown and did this and that in the office and so on. And you go on and on and on and you suddenly discover that what you've described has absolutely nothing to do with what happened. You've described a fleshless list of abstractions. Whereas if you were actually aware of what went on, you could never describe it. Because nature is multidimensional. Language is linear. Language is scrawny. And therefore, if you identify the world as it is with the way the world is described, it's as if you were trying to eat dollar bills and expect a nutritious diet. Or eat numbers. A lot of people eat numbers. People play the stock market. They're doing nothing but eating numbers. And they're always unhappy, absolutely miserable, because they never get anything. So therefore, they always hope more is coming, because they believe that if they eat enough dollar bills, eventually something satisfactory will happen. So eating the abstractions all the time, we want more, more, more time. Confucius very wisely said, a man who understands the Tao in the morning may die with content in the evening. Because when you understand, you don't put your hope in time. Time won't solve a thing. And the Christian word for sinning in Greek is amatanin, which means to miss the point. And the point is eternal life, which is here and now. But until there is silence of the mind, it is almost impossible to understand eternal life, that is to say, eternal now. When you are fully aware and not thinking, you will notice some amazing absences. There is no past. Can you hear anything past, incidentally? Can you hear anything future? They're just not there to the plain sense of one's ears. Well, I remember in the Sermon on the Mount that Jesus said a lot of things about this. Consider the lilies of the field, how they grow. They toil not, neither do they spin. And yet, Suleiman in all his glory was not clothed like one of these. And if God so clothes the grass of the field, which today is and tomorrow is cast into the oven, shall he not much more clothe you, faithless ones? Wow. So, do not worry about tomorrow, saying, what shall we eat, what shall we drink, or how shall we clothe ourselves? Oh, the rabble seeks after these things. Sufficient to the day is the worry of it. Nobody ever preaches a sermon on that text. Never. I've heard lots of sermons. And never one on that one. because people say, look, that's all very well because Jesus was the boss's son. And he knew, you see, that he was really in charge of the universe and he had nothing to worry about. But we have to be practical. Oh, what do you suppose the gospel was? The good news. Do you know it never got out? You too are the boss's son. That was the gospel. Lots of people in India know that perfectly well. When you get to be a certain age and after you've studied long enough with a certain guru, then and then only may you realize this. If you've put in the time, they finally let you in. Here you have to wait until you're dead. The only place to begin is now. Because here's where we are. So why put it off? A lot of people say, well, I'm not ready. What do you mean you're not ready? What do you have to be ready? I'm not good enough. I'm perhaps not old enough, not mature enough. Still am frightened of pain. I'm still dependent on material things. I have to, you know, eat a lot and drink a lot. And I better get all that under control first. Oh? You want to be able to congratulate yourself for having gone through the discipline which is rewarded with realization. That is trying to quench fire with fire. Wouldn't it be great to have no fear? No attachments, no hang-ups. To be as free as the air. Wouldn't it be crazy to have that courage? And you look into yourself honestly, and you find that inside you're actually a quaking mess of sensitivity. Running away from the quaking mess. Escaping. You never can. There's nothing you can actually do to transform your own nature into unattached selflessness. Because you have a selfish reason for wanting to do it. What does it mean that you can't do anything about it? It's singing loud and clear. The reason you can't do anything about it is that you don't exist. You, as you conceive yourself to be, that is your ego, your image of yourself, isn't there. It doesn't exist. It's an abstraction. Well, when you understand that, you're liberated. There's the happening, the suchness. Yes, sure, you bet. But it's not pushing you around because there's no you to be pushed around. So this illusion of the persecuted ego who is pushed around by fate, it's altogether disappeared. And so in likewise, the illusion of the ego who pushes fate around has also disappeared. There's a happening. By dying to yourself, by having become completely incompetent and found that you don't exist, you're reborn. You become everything. In the words of Sir Edwin Arnold, foregoing self, the universe grows I.